In the name of the glorious Trinity, Father and Son and Holy Spirit, forever. Amen. Glory be to the everlasting mercies which sent you to us, O Christ, the light of the world and the life of all. Give us wisdom by your law and enlighten our impulses by your knowledge. Sanctify our souls by your truth and grant that we may be obedient to your words and may fulfill your commandments at every hour. O you who enlightens the rational with the knowledge of your greatness, do enlighten, O my Lord, our thoughts, that we may meditate upon your holy and divine scriptures at all times, O Lord of all, Father and Son and Holy Spirit forever. Amen.
Expression, and I quote, move mountains or moving mountains means to do something that seems almost impossible or to make a strenuous or an energetic effort to achieve something difficult. Now, that's according to AI's overview and the world standard and requirement. However, Christ, praise be to his name, has instructed otherwise. Because he's not of this world, his words, his deeds, his kingdom, his grace, his mercy, his love, his kindness is not of this world. In Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, Jesus says to his disciples, if you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you may say to this mountain, move from here, and it will move. Now, this is when he was replying to his disciples' question as to their inability to cast out a lunatic demon from a boy. And it was because, Jesus says, lack of their faith. Now, at face value, we think, wow, and we wonder what type, what amount, what volume, what quantity, or what quality of faith do we need to possess to move mountains? Well, Jesus gives us that quality or that type of faith we need to move mountains. Mustard seed. A grain of mustard seed. Now, let's ascertain why mustard seed, why not other seeds? You know, not only because it is the smallest of the seeds, according to Christ's remarks in Mark chapter 4, verse 31. Now, a side note, orchard seeds are smaller. Did you know that there are smaller seeds than a mustard seed? A grain of orchard seed is smaller. So, did Jesus err for those skeptics and those evolutionists? No, he didn't. He didn't make a mistake. You know, in the region of Galilee, North Israel, where Jesus was preaching, at that moment, there were no orchard trees. They weren't familiar with the orchard trees. So he uses the seed that was readily available and they were familiar with. So back to why mustard seed. Mari Shudad of Hadith, mid-8th century, comments, just as it is said that the grain of mustard seed is not divided into two like other seeds because it's small, thus also you shall not be doubtful about what is in your hands, what you have readily available in Jesus Christ in our faith. For, he goes on to say, Christ shows that faith is wanted, is necessary by the patient and by the physicians. Now, he's referring to the father of the child who was possessed by a lunatic demon whom the disciples couldn't cast out. And Jesus got a little bit angry and rebuked them and said, bring him to me. And he commanded and the lunatic or the demon came out of the son. What Jesus is saying to his disciples, it's not just you that is of little faith, but the Father also lacked faith. You see, when a priest goes to pray on someone who is in hospital, when you require a priest to attend to you while you're in hospital or you're sick, to anoint you, to pray on you, to anoint you, according to the scriptures, you know, faith works both ways. It's the physician's faith, that is the priest's faith, and it's the patient's faith that work together. So now we have been guaranteed by Jesus Christ, again, praise be to his name. And I've told you, beloved, each time you hear the name Jesus Christ, give him a little praise in your heart, in your mind, in your soul. We've been now guaranteed by Jesus Christ that off the bat, moving mountains needs a small yet undivided faith. It all begins with faith. Faith in what we have graciously been promised by God, which is in our hands, at our disposal. It's there, beloved. All the promises of God, the power of God, the comfort of God is there for you and I to be used to move the mountains in our lives. Now again, as a side note, remember the Canaanite woman in Matthew chapter 15 who came and asked the Lord, pleaded with the Lord that he would heal her demon-possessed daughter? What does Jesus state? What is his reply to her before he actually grants what she is requesting? Jesus states that her faith was great. Now, is there a contradiction? Small faith there, a great faith here. No. What Christ is indicating is that she had such a great undivided faith. Why? Though being a Gentile, remember, the disciples were Jews. Though this woman was a Gentile, and as Saint Theodore of Mopsuestia comments, having seen her advocates unsuccessful, that is, the disciples, who basically were trying to shoo her away and said to the Lord, send her away, give her what she wants, send her away, for she is crying after us. That didn't work. The woman then appeals for herself and she doesn't stop. She's a Gentile, remember? But look at the faith she had, the undivided faith. Hers is greater because she is a Gentile. And in fact, she says to the Lord, help me. In other words, I haven't been asking nothing for myself. I'm not selfish. I'm not asking for myself. I'm asking for my daughter. And yes, I will take the insult. I'll take your insult. I will take your rejection. But just grant me my request. This is a mountain in my life, she was saying. She does not complain even when she was insulted, obviously not by Jesus Christ. We're not going to talk about that. We'll come one day. We'll talk about how God, we learn from this, that the Lord will use your most difficult circumstances and situations, will continue to allow to go through for a greater deed and a greater glory for his name and for the reply of our requests. That is the small undivided faith we need to move our mountains, beloved. What mountains do you have in your life? Stop and think. Stop everything. Stop driving. Pull over to one side. Stop typing on your computer if you're listening and typing. Stop talking to one another if you're listening to this podcast. Stop the dishwashing, the vacuuming, the diaper changing, whatever it is. Stop. Think for yourself. And I'm sure you don't even need to think too hard. They're always there in your mind. They're in front of you. They're in before your eyes. What are the mountains that you have in your life that you've been trying to move? Weakness? Bad habits? Demons? Addictions? Drug? Alcohol? Gambling? Pornification? Is that what it's called? Porn? Sexual immorality, doubt itself. What are the mountains you have? What are you so overwhelmed and burdened and heavy laden by these mountains in your life? Well, beloved, sit at ease. a sigh of relief. Comfort and relief are in your hands. They are there for your disposal. They are there for you. Now, even though all that is required is a great undivided faith in the power of Jesus Christ, our Lord God, yet we have something from our behalf. Jesus does not just merely say that you need faith as small as a mustard seed. That is the beginning. That is the stepping stone. We in unison require the armor to enter this battle, to overcome and move this mountain. We need the armory. We need the weapons. Those being, as stated by Christ, fasting and prayer. Fasting for the body and prayer for the soul. Again, Mari Shudad comments, by fasting, he alludes to the perseverance in good works which are necessary to be acquired. What does that mean? That means you want to move the mountain, you got to stop those issues that you have. You have to stop those burdens. You have to refrain from the deeds that have created and placed the mountains and the burdens and the heavy ladens in your life and concentrate on the good deeds. Which are the good deeds? Those which God had from the first, according to Ephesians chapter 2, those which God had from the first, from the beginning, prepared that we should walk in them. You see, works that are deemed good and pleasing to God will not produce, create the burdensome and the heavy mountains that you have produced in your life. Stop. Fasting means cut out. So again, if you have a mountain and that mountain is titled gambling, lust, hatred, envy, these are the mountains that are overwhelming us and overbearing us. If you have these, you got to stop those. Because if you continue with that, they're just going to be more overwhelming. It is those works that have created the burdensome and the heavy mountains, beloved. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 to 30, Jesus instructs, come unto me. Listen to this. Come unto me, all you who have labored and forced to bear burdens. There is an invitation for you. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Do you want the sky to open up and an angel to come down and say, Shimshon, Yuchanan, Shushan, Tom, Tony, Stephen, come to me? No, that ain't going to happen. That will not happen, beloved. The calling is there. Jesus is alive. Praise he be to his name. Jesus is everlasting. Praise be to his name. His instructions, his commands, his promises are everlasting. Come unto me, all you who labor and are forced to bear burdens, and I shall give you rest. Now, he's going to give us a burden. He wants to give us a rest. He's promising rest, but he says, take my yoke. That means take my burden. And you're saying, oh, Nashana, I want to get rid of burdens. Christ is calling me. He's luring me to a greater yoke. No, no, listen. Listen to what Christ is promising. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am peaceful and meek in my heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is pleasant and my burden is light. Yes, even though, see, he's still calling them burdens, yokes. Why? Let me give you an example. We need to pray for our enemies. We need to pray for one another. Who is your enemy? Do you have an enemy? Think about it. Do you have someone who's disappointed you, who has broken your heart and has stabbed you in the back, and you don't ever want to speak to that person because they have truly disappointed and hurt you? You may say and claim, fakely, that's not my enemy. Well, it's almost there. Right? Jesus says you need to forgive. Now, that's a burden. That is a burden. For you and I to forgive those who hurt us, it's burdensome. You know, we're very reluctant at times. It's like we don't want to hear that. But, when we do, When we take on this burden and we forgive our enemies and we forgive those who have trespassed against us, that's when you feel light, because you don't have a burden anymore. There's no more enemies. You've forgiven the person. Now, whether the person accepts it or not, that's up to Christ. You leave that in the perfect, righteous judgment of Jesus Christ. See, these are the burdens, but they're light. They're beautiful when you forgive someone, when you repent, when you do away with what is unpleasing to God. Then he also gifts us with another armor, beloved. It's prayer. What we roll our eyes when we hear prayer. That's all you say, prayer. That's all we need to do. Of course, we need to pray, because when he says prayer, Marishudat comments, he implies love towards God. You know, I learned something new. Stephen, I learned something new when I was preparing this. When we pray, it's because of our love towards God. He implies love towards God, by which we are moved to virtuous conduct. If we love God, we will conduct ourselves in a manner demonstrating that genuine and heartfelt love we have for God. Our love for God is evident in our conduct in life. When we pray to God, it is not so much to be granted and that we may be content when we receive, but rather that when we do receive, by it we glorify God because of our genuine love for God. When I want to repent from an addiction, an immorality, a sin, and I pray to God, it's not only to be granted that, but so that I can show and express my love to the Lord when I do overcome and repent, out of my love for God. St. John the Evangelist, in his proclamation, chapter 3, verse 16, writes, "For God so loved the world in this way, so much that he would give up his Son, the only one, so that everyone who trusts in him shall not be lost, but he shall have eternal life." Our 3:16 should read in this manner, "For we love God in this way so much that we would surrender our will, our desire, our entire life at his feet, so that we do all to please him and him alone, because he is God and I love him, period." By prayer, we acknowledge and resign to the truth that it is God alone, and through his strength alone, we can move our mountains, so that we may live for him, with him, and by him. So let's begin to identify the mountains we have in our lives that are so overwhelming and weighing us down. Again, is it personal, mental issues, spiritual issues, family issues, relationships, marriages, health, faith, finance, demons, addictions? You can keep adding. You add as you please, as you identify. So what do we do, beloved? First and foremost, know that the enemy, Satan, most definitely, most assuredly has a hand in it, or is around the crime scene, most definitely. Hence, Jesus gives us the instructions, fasting and prayer. Remember, he's referring to the casting of the lunatic demon, Satan, demon. Second, we need to believe in the power of the name of God the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, from whom demons shudder. We have this. This is ours, beloved. This is in our hand. And we need to be undivided in our thoughts and our actions and our deeds and our understanding, that know assuredly, confidently, that we have that power. Thirdly, bring your fast, and not from food alone, but more so from the disease which have burdened and laden you. The diseases, not the symptoms, but the disease. Why? What has caused this mountain to appear in my life? Why? What? What is the purpose? What is the reason? Now, did you note that Jesus states that it needs to be fasting and praying? Why? Fasting before praying is that we are not distracted and enticed by our weaknesses and the enemy. When you fast, you subdue your mind, your thoughts, your body. You're in that spiritual realm, beloved, so that when you begin to pray to portray and reflect your love for God, you're praying in the spirit and not the body, because the body is now hammered. The body is crying out, food, dolma, basra, food. No, no, no. And the soul is saying, shh, quiet, quiet. I'm having an amazing time with my Lord, and I want to show my Lord how much I love him through my prayer. Fourthly, pray to God and ask that he strengthens you to overcome, beloved, so that you can appease him with your repentance, with your new walk in life, reflecting again and confirming your unconditional love for him. And lastly, do what all those who received from Jesus did, as we read in the Holy Scriptures. We forget to do this, beloved. We are so overwhelmed and we are so pleased and we are so joyous when we receive, we forget to do this. Praise and worship him, beloved, unceasingly, privately and publicly. That is at church, the public worship. And tell it to all, beloved. Tell all what God has done for you and remain steadfast until his return. Praise and glory be to his name, now and at all times and forever. Amen.
Hope you enjoyed this week's message. Please don't forget to rate and review this podcast and share with your friends and family. For any future topic suggestions or to give us detailed feedback, please visit our link in the show notes, linktr.ee/doubleedgedsword. Until next time, God bless you all.